Penguin Random House Audio presents All My Mother's Lovers by Ilana Masad, read for you by Rebecca Lowman, with a dedication and acknowledgments read by the author.
To Ima, Andy, my mother, who is not the mother in this book. Vele Abba Uri, Shetamid Iti.
What you do to children matters, and they might never forget. Toni Morrison, God Help the Child. The truth is, the world will probably whittle your daughter down, but a mother never should. Meg Wolitzer, The Interestings. I'll tell you a secret. A lot of times, parents are not the best at seeing their children clearly. Celeste Ng, Little Fires Everywhere. August 21st, 2017. Maggie is in the midst of a second lazy orgasm when her brother Ariel calls to tell her their mother has died. "Don't pick up," Lucia says, the lower half of her face glistening. But Maggie doesn't listen. She lives for moments like this. "Hello, brother. I am currently being eaten out. What are you up to?" And when Lucia pulls her face away, peeved, Maggie leans up on her elbows and says, "No, don't stop." But then she listens, and she sits up and pulls away from Lucia, tugs her knees close to her body, protective. She can feel her face turn stony, is sure the color is draining from it as her brother talks. She sees how she must look through her lover's shifting features, Lucia's eyes widening with concern, her mouth hanging open a little, chin still wet. "Okay," Maggie says. She repeats it. Then, "I'll text you my flight details." She doesn't say, "I'm sorry," though she is, nor "I love you," though she does. She can't think clearly enough to say the things people are supposed to say in such moments. Not because she's stuck. She isn't. She isn't even thinking about her newly dead mother, nor of the violence of her death, a car crash along a route she can picture well. Instead, Maggie is several steps ahead, thinking of the funeral, of who she needs to call, of what will happen to her father. She's thinking about whether they need to print programs, whether the synagogue will do that, and whether that's even really a thing, or just something people do on TV. She's thinking about her planner, sitting in the kitchen, so far from where she needs it. "Mags, you're scaring me," Lucia says. She's sitting very close to Maggie now, rather than between her legs, kneeling, her brown breasts hanging heavy, nipples grazing Maggie's knees. "Where are you going?" Maggie stays hunched into her phone, looking at flight options, prices, and times. "Home," she says, and she leans forward to kiss Lucia, whose lips look especially swollen, though it's just that her lipstick is smeared, despite its no-smear promise. "You've got a smudge," she says, and thumbs it away. "My mom died." "What?" Maggie tends to shriek when she's surprised, but Lucia goes soft and still. It makes people lean forward to hear and somehow amplifies her presence. It's one of the things Maggie likes about her so much, her solidness, the space she takes up without trying. "Babe, your mom?" "Yeah," Maggie says, lowering her eyes to her phone again. A tree crashed into her car. "Can you hand me my wallet?" But Lucia pulls the phone out of her hands instead. "Hey." Lucia holds Maggie's face in cupped palms, looks into her eyes like she's trying to find something there, something that isn't. "I think you're in shock." "No, I'm not." Maggie jerks her head away and gets up. "Fuck it, it'll be easier on the laptop." She grabs her underwear from the ground, pulls on the baggy Babadook t-shirt she wears to sleep, and walks out to the living room where her laptop is still hooked up to the TV, paused on the credits of the documentary she and Lucia had been watching. It's Monday already, the night having turned early morning without her realizing. She needs to compose an email to her boss to explain why she won't be at work for a few days. She needs to call her dad. She needs, "What can I do?" Lucia has followed her, still naked, and hands Maggie the wallet she left in the bedroom on the chain she keeps attached to her jeans. Maggie doesn't know what to say because she doesn't know what Lucia can do. Her mother has never died before. She's never before had a girlfriend for this long, this many months in a row. She doesn't know what having a person help her in this intimate way should look like. She can't ask Lucia to call her dad for her. She can't ask Lucia to look up flights for her. She can't ask Lucia to figure out how to get hold of the will and whether her parents still have the same lawyer now as they did a decade ago, a plucky blonde woman named Janice, whom Maggie had the displeasure of meeting when she got arrested for smoking pot at age 17. She isn't even sure what she's told Lucia about her mother, whether they've really talked about their parents. It seems like they've been too busy fucking the life out of each other for most of the past 5 months. When Maggie's foot begins to fall asleep, she realizes how long she's been sitting with it underneath her on the couch. The same position her mother always sits, an inherited trait, or maybe a picked-up habit. Sat, she thinks. The same way her mother sat. The tense change feels like a fist around Maggie's esophagus, its permanence making the edges of her vision cloud. But no, she can't fall apart yet. There are practicalities to attend to. She's been staring at flight options for far too long, switching to another tab and Googling how to plan a funeral fast and Jewish funeral and what to do when your mom dies. She pulls her credit card out of her wallet, inputs the numbers. The tips of her fingers are numb. A mug of tea appears next to the laptop. Not steaming, which is good, because Maggie can't drink anything hot. She usually puts an ice cube in her tea to avoid needing to wait 15 minutes before drinking it. Lucia must have seen her do this. Or maybe it's been that long already. Here you go, babe, Lucia says, and sits on the couch next to Maggie, her hip, now underpantsed, her torso t-shirted, pressed close. Did you find a flight? Yeah, in the morning. We should get a few hours of sleep before I drive you to the airport. Come on, let's go to bed. You're driving me? Maggie looks up from an unhelpful listicle of 10 things no one expects when losing a parent. Lucia's irises are usually two different shades of brown, one deep and rich, and the other golden in the light, almost like an eagle's eye. In the shadow of the dark living room and the glow of the laptop screen, they just look black. As if all pupil, like on the night she and Maggie met, both of them on Molly and dancing to EDM at an overpriced warehouse party. Of course. I mean, if you don't want me to, I won't. But I'm here, babe. Maggie wants her to. She also doesn't. This is not where they're at yet. This is what she usually considers too real. This is when she bails. Look. She starts, but she can't go on, and so she doesn't say that Lucia doesn't have to, or that she should leave, or that Maggie wants to be alone, because it isn't true. She doesn't want to sleep alone, if she can even sleep. She wants Lucia's teddy bear warmth. She exhales. Okay. August 21st, 2017. In the barely there light of early morning, Maggie pulls her medium suitcase out from under the bed. She doesn't know if there's going to be a shiva or not, doesn't know what her mother would want, if she wanted anything, if she had any plans. Was she too young for that? Maggie has to stop what she's doing and calculate from the birth year in order to zero in on her mother's age. 63, she thinks, sweat pooling in her armpits at the shame of not remembering. Can you turn that off? She snaps at Lucia, who's making coffee in the kitchen, her phone playing a soothing acoustic guitar playlist. I need to concentrate. The music stops mid-strum, and Maggie feels even worse. She'll pack enough clothes for 10 days, just in case they do a shiva. Her dad is a lapsed Catholic, and she and Ariel weren't raised particularly anything, though when she was small, when her maternal grandparents were both still alive, they would visit from New York to celebrate the high holidays, going to synagogue and eating lavish meals at the rarely used dining room table. She has only glimpses of those years, the softness of Bubby's hands, how everyone said Maggie looked just like Nano, which confused her because he was bald. She does remember her mother crying when the calls came about their deaths, barely a year apart. And she remembers her mother packing, though that seemed to be a constant activity. Now it's my turn, Maggie thinks. She packs work clothes because those are appropriate, some of her all-purpose jeans and tank tops for lounging around or doing errands in, and the obligatory black dress and heels. Why women need to wear heels to funerals, she doesn't know, especially when everyone ends up poking holes in the grass when they reach the cemetery. What she does know is that it's expected. Are you ready? Got your ID, money, phone? Lucia hovers at the door, clutching a thermos of coffee for them to share. Her hair is pulled back into the severe ponytail she wears on a day-to-day basis, so tight that it flattens her curls to her scalp.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.